When we think about film aesthetics, we think about camera movement, lighting, colors, special effects, etc. All of these elements have a place in the aesthetic of cinema and all influence narrative. In the world of CGI and other special effects imagery, are we steering too far away from thinking about how basic filmmaking techniques can enhance our narratives? One of the rudimentary tools that filmmakers have at their disposal to carry aesthetic, narrative and movement, is the aspect ratio. Contemporary filmmakers limit themselves by using the aspect ratio as a constant and not as an additional shape-shifting storytelling technique. What is an aspect ratio? Really, it's the height and width of our image, and it started out as nearly a square. Our first aspect ratio was 4:3. Edison came up with this by counting the perforations on a bit of 35 millimeter film stock and deciding upon four perforations tall on either side. Iconic films such as Gone with the Wind, The Wizard of Oz, and Citizen Kane were all shot in this aspect ratio. It became standard for motion picture companies in the United States until 1952, when filmmakers began testing their limits. How the West Has Won was released in 1962 on what is called anamorphic widescreen, or Cinerama, 2.59:1, which required a multi-camera, multi-projector setup. Typically, this ratio and 2.76:1 are used for road shows and accompanied by 70mm film, like you may have seen with The Hateful Eight in 2015. It was later discovered that a 2.35:1 ratio achieved a similar effect, but with the use of only one projector. Widescreen films became standard, and 4:3 was pushed out the door. Now we consider wider aspect ratios to be more cinematic, such as popular films like Blade Runner 2049. Typically, films are shot in 16:9 and then post-cropped to become 2.35:1. Since technological advancements push the aspect ratio to widen, we now consider 4:3 to be rudimentary, and for 16:9 or Cinerama to be more visually pleasing. The choice of aspect ratio has become an aesthetic one rather than being based upon technology. Even though filmmakers have this aesthetic choice, they tend to refrain from using it. We all know this funny-looking dude up here, Mr. Sergei Eisenstein. Not only did he develop the montage, but he was also a world-renowned film theorist. One of his series, The Dynamic Square, mentions how the frame of a film can be used to influence the images in its container. Adjusting the dimensions of the frame allows for filmmakers to venture into all the multitude of expressive rectangles in the world. In many ways, Eisenstein predicted the progressive use of horizontal space in the frame more than vertical. He tells how the vertical portion of the screen is yet to be explored. We associate horizontal frames with being more cinematic and vertical frames as being more point and shoot, such as with cell phones. So even though we have vertical frames with Snapchat and Instagram, that's not quite what he meant by utilizing the vertical portion of the frame. Rather, that films and cinema should be using it more for more height than width. Changes in the amount of image filling the container can be used for more dramatic shifts in story or to allude to an emotion. Much like how we move the camera and compose shots, the shift in container dimensions can achieve the same aesthetic qualities. Even though filmmakers have creative freedom concerning the aspect ratios that they use, they still tend to use 16:9 unless it's necessary for them to use something else. Either the shift in frame is due to wanting to show expansiveness, moving from smaller aspect ratio to larger, to show changes in time, or for different projection methods. Christopher Nolan, when creating The Dark Knight Rises, used both 16:9 and IMAX ratio. Even though the decision to use them was due to technology, the addition of IMAX was an aesthetic choice. The primary issue when using aspect ratio change only to shift between different forms of cameras or projection is that it can be jarring. Jolting between aspect ratios was a complaint of many audience members when seeing the film in theaters. Not only is it jarring in theaters, but also in home when there's standard definition and not IMAX. When the shift between aspect ratios is intentional and purposeful, it can add to narrative and over in the aesthetic of film. Wes Anderson achieved this with Grand Budapest Hotel. He purposely uses aspect ratio change to fit with the stylization of his films. We all know Wes for his witty characters and abrupt camera moves, and he uses that same technique here. The three aspect ratios he uses are standard widescreen format, the Academy ratio, and CinemaScope. Each aspect ratio used in the film is associated with a certain time period. Each ratio is used to evoke a separate, different feeling in the viewer. The year 1985 in the film is shot in 1.85:1 with dull color palettes and flat planes, whereas the communist period is shot in 2.35:1, anamorphic, and instills a different, more rounded feeling of vastness. The rest of the film outside of these two eras is played in 16:9. It's important to note that he uses the aspect ratio as a tool in his tool belt rather than thinking of it as a technological restriction of his creative process, which is what Eisenstein was referring to in his essay, The Dynamic Square. Anderson comes close to achieving the dynamic square, but does not quite make it. When Eisenstein was expressing what Eisenstein was expressing was the aspect ratios can shape shift within takes and become part of the movement within the scene. Anderson primarily used it in between cuts and transitions so that it wouldn't jar the viewers. One current film, Xavier Dolan's Mommy, actually moved the frame during a take. This is more of what Eisenstein meant by allowing the frame to shapeshift. Both commercially and culturally, the widescreen format is considered to be standard and more aesthetically pleasing. Even ever since the conception of widescreen ratios, filmmakers have been searching for ways to push the horizontal limits of the frame, but not the vertical. Directors of short films tend to use 2.35 to 1 to make their 10-minute films seem more cinematic. As seen with the evolution between Academy ratio and widescreen, changes in film take time. Academy ratio was sought out for the standard for a long period of time, but before a filmmaker came along decided to shake the status quo. Current filmmakers should be taking a piece from Eisenstein's theory and testing out the unlimited possibilities of the container that films are held in. There is much potential for unique storytelling through utilizing a shape-shifting aspect ratio.